just continue to pray for Pastor Mansur for his full recovery. You know, this time it wasn't so bad, you know. He's still in pain, discomfort, don't get me wrong, but he's not laid up in the bed just in misery like the last surgery, so we thank God for that. And I also wanted to just give you guys an update. As we all know, Auntie Evelyn's mother had passed a few weeks ago, and Mom and I went over there. Well, our Fridays were checking, and Mom dropped me off, and we got to visit with her a little bit and just talk with her and just, you know, hang out with her, just showing comfort. Because this is the time, you know, after the funeral, and we all know that, after the funeral, the cards stop, the calls stop, and then it's that time for you to reflect, mourn, and grieve. That's when the grieving process begins. And this is the time in which we, as not only her family, but her Christian family, got to get in and rally around her. But I have to just say this and let the world know what a wonderful job she and Uncle Robert is doing with those children. Yeah. I mean, they have taken children that were unwanted and unloved, and they have given them a sense of purpose. They are now wanted. They are now loved. They have their room set up so nice. And, you know, she's so neat and clean. I want to be like her in my room. And, yes, anime. And, I mean, she just is really just taking care of those kids. You know, a few of them were in trouble because, you know, kids are children. And she had them doing their stuff, and she was making sure that they have a sense of self-worth. And that she was telling the girls, you know, you have to be clean, young ladies, because they weren't raised. You know, foster parents, they don't care sometimes. You know, I'm not saying that all do, because there's a lot of great foster parents out there. But the 10 or 15% that don't care, that's how many children's lives that they are affecting. Amen. So I just wanted to thank God for them. Thank God for the work that they're doing, the ministry that they're actually carrying on in their house right now. Mm-hmm. So, thank the Lord for people like Auntie Evelyn and Uncle Robert. Amen. So, speaking of thank you, Tracy, we're out over there. We're going to talk about a box full of thank you. Oh, now, a box full of thank you, you probably want to know a box full of thank you. Well, there's a challenge at the end of this sermon that I'm going to give to each and every one of you regarding a box full of thank you. But each and every one of us should have a box full of thank you right here in your chest. Amen. It's on that wonderful left side between your abdomen and your neck. It's this little space called your heart. And you're supposed to have a box in your heart. And it's supposed to be full of thank you notes that God the Father and Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit can just tap into and read every now and again. Amen. So each of us need to have that box in our heart and in our spirit, and most importantly, in our minds. So if we are God's creation, we're made to praise Him. Psalms 5:11 says, But let all who take refuge in you rejoice. Let them sing joyful praises forever. Spread your protection over them, that all who love your name may be filled with joy. You know, that unspeakable joy. I used to be one of my cuts. Unspeakable joy. I got joy, unspeakable joy. That song gave you joy just singing. I mean, you have to be dead not to dance off that song. But that's the kind of joy that we should have in the Lord. And when you have that kind of joy, you have to thank Him. You got to be like, I thank you for giving me the joy that I have in my life today. Amen. Now, we're given this perfect creation. We have sunlight, we're not too far away from the sun, we're not too close to the sun, we have summer days, we have winter days. For those of you who like me, don't like to be hot. We've got the grass, we've got the birds singing, we've got flowers, we have this beautiful creation. And sometimes we forget how beautiful this creation is.
Right.
So, as Christians, we are a little salt of the earth, little lights on top of the hill at night. We have to remind not only ourselves, right, our fellow Christians, but most importantly, the world, of how beautiful this creation is.
Amen.
Mankind was given the job to take care of the earth. Adam and Eve's only job was to worship the Lord and take care of the Garden of Eden. That was their job. That's a good job. I like that job. You get free benefits, you get room and board, but most importantly, you get to have a direct relationship with the one who made you.
Yes.
Now, I don't know about y'all, but to be able to walk in the garden with God, I mean, awesome songs. I would have liked to have that opportunity. But the cool part about it is we will again, soon and very soon. So when you keep blessings and thankfulness in your mouth and you're always singing praises, you don't have time to spew out venom.
Amen.
You don't have time to put people down. You don't have time to talk about them. You don't have time to be negative. You don't have time to complain. You don't have time to just be like, well, I don't know what to tell you. You don't have time for that because you know what to tell that person. Pray about it. Let's pray about it together. Let me pray about it in my own personal prayers. Because when prayers go up, blessings come down. So that's why God says keep your mind on good things so the evil one can't get in. Because he's always there. He's just like right here. Just foot always trying to be in the door. But if you keep the door shut and sealed and locked off, he can't come in so that you can fully bathe in the wondrous glow of God. Now, some of you may be asking, well, how do you thank God? Well, I can't give him a thank you card. I can't buy him a gift because, you know, he kind of already told me that the gold is mine, the silver is mine, it's all mine. So, if y'all don't know where that verse is, it's Haggai 2, verse 8. The gold is his, the silver is his, the diamonds, the rubies, the oil. Everything is his, including you. You're his too. Today, while I was getting ready for church, I heard a televangelist, and he's really good. I would love to see him in Louisiana one day. And he said, redemption means that something has been bought and paid for. Jesus bought and paid for the world.
Yes.
Not just Christians,
yes,
not just Jews, or as those of us that are really educated, Israel, not just Israel and the lost 10 and the 10 we know of, but he bought the world. From Adam and Eve to the last baby born during the Great Tribulation. He bought and paid and died for them. So we're his. You can't sell your soul to the devil. This man came into his church and said, I done sold my soul to the devil. I can't come to church because I done sold my soul to the devil. He said, man, you ain't sold your soul to the devil. The devil ain't got the money to pay for your soul. When Jesus died for you, he bought your soul. Because the wages of sin are death. And when you sin, you are bankrupt. Your debt is death. So it takes innocent blood to pay your debt. And we all know Satan ain't innocent. So what is he buying? Nothing. He's blowing smoke. So man came on in and ministered and long and short of the story is that man is now doing well and he is now learning and appreciating the Lord. So that's being thankful. So what do we give to God to show our thanks? You can't give him something physical. So we know that. So that's not real. Spiritually, we're bankrupt. So it takes him to redeem us spiritually. So how do we show him that we're thankful? Well, because he created us in his image, then we've got similarities to God. We can think, we can listen, we can smell, we can taste, we can talk, we can rationalize. So if we can do all those things like God, there is a way for us to thank him. It's just not a physical thing that you can give and hand to him. So these are three ways that you can show God that you are thankful. First, you thank him with your mouth.
Amen.
Confess with your mouth. Remember that? First, confessing with your mouth, letting everybody know, I'm a Christian. So say it with your mouth. Second, tell someone. That's the second way that you can be thankful to God. You can show thanks to God. By telling someone else what God is doing for you.
Yes.
Then third is the best gift that you can give. You know how you can give a woman diamonds, that's one of the best gifts you can give her, or a man a Corvette. Well, the best gift you can give God is obedience.
Yes.
He told Saul, obedience is better than sacrifice. And that's what God wants from us, is obedience. That's how you show you're thankful.
Amen.
So let's break those down. Now, when you talk to God, you're in prayer. But I like to talk to God just on general purposes. I don't have to have a formal setting to talk to God. I just talk to God. So, when you're talking to God, he never does this. Crystal, I'm going to have to call you right back because I got to go handle Jimmy over here with this crisis. You know, I'm going to take a little lunch break and I'm going to holler at you at 2, okay? All right? Good looking out. He's never too busy. He never has to take the time out to talk to you. That's the cool part about God. He just is. So he can talk to you and talk to 3,000 other people all at the same time. And you guys are having individual conversations.
Amen.
I mean, that is the awesome power of the Lord. And if you want to get a real deep with it, not only are you praying to Jesus Christ, but you got God the Father in on the conversation, you got the Holy Spirit on the conversation, you got the angels, like, all right, Lord, ready to go? All right, let's go. You got the entire heavenly host, which it is billions of them, just billions with a B, that are ready to take care of you. Billions at your beck and call. I mean, kings and queens have servants that are at their beck and call all the time. But I don't know about y'all, I'd rather have heaven at my beck and call. And they do it because they love us. So you got the entire heavenly host taking care of you. I don't know about y'all, but that right there is enough to be thankful for. So, Jesus and God the Father and the Holy Spirit, they're like our parents. And Jesus is our elder brother. So he's the one that always lays across the bed and talks to you about your life. When I was growing up, me and Mom would have these life conversations. She told me about everything. Everything that I needed to be a woman, a mother, and a wife. She helped guide me by we laying in the bed or across the bed or in the living room or in the kitchen or out and about talking. What's going on in your life? Jesus wants to take an interest in you. He has an interest in you. He's taking an interest in you. You don't even know it. The trick is you taking interest in him. And when you do that, oh man, talk about the blessing. And it's not about material wealth. Peace of mind.
Yes.
You ain't got to worry about your babies or your husband or your family members in jail. Come on, black people in here, we know what's going on out there in the world. You don't have to worry about your loved ones on drugs. You don't have to worry about you not having enough money in the bank account, enough food on the table. Because God's got you.
Yes.
Let him get you.
Yes, amen.
And then you'll be so thankful for him getting you that you'll be running around like David was, just praising you till your clothes fall off. Just, yes, Lord, yes. So when you pray to God, it doesn't have to be this formal thing when you're on your knees with your hands clasped up in this famous thing here. And Lord, we come before your throne this afternoon to thank you for the wonderful things that you have given. You don't need to have all that. You just say, Lord, I got some things on my mind. Or Lord, I want to thank you for allowing me to have gas to get from here to there. That's all you got to do. Now, Jesus did give the disciples the model prayer. He did, because the disciples asked him, well, how do we pray? You know, the priests pray for us. But how do we pray now that we have this direct connection with God? So let's go to Matthew 6. Go to Matthew 6, verse 7. Matthew 6, verse 7. It says, when you pray, don't babble, you know, Lord, I want to invite. 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 Don't do that. Because you're having a conversation with God when you pray. The only way for you to, for him to understand you is you've got to speak clearly. Don't babble on and on as people of other religions do. You know, I don't give a religious thing, a religious example, but if you just constantly are in chant about something, just constant enchant. Don't do that. You don't have to keep asking over and over and over and over again. Just like a parent with a child. Mommy, 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 what? Mommy. God doesn't want that type of relationship. So don't babble on and on and on. Of other religions do. They think their prayers are answered merely by repeating their words again and again. Can I, have, this, today, today. No. Don't be like them, for your Father knows exactly what you need even before you ask him. So he gave the model prayer. He's covering all our bases. He said, pray like this. Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept whole. May your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So Lord, may you continue to be you and look out over me, and may whatever you say go on in heaven, that it be fulfilled out in the earth, so the earth can continue to go on as it is. It says, give us today the food we need. Or for those in King James Version, give us today our daily bread. And forgive us of our sins, in some translations as transgressions, as we have forgiven those who have sinned against us. So he's saying you have to have forgiveness in your heart so that you can be forgiven. Don't let us yield to temptation or lead us into temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. basically your model prayer that you would pray every night and you cover all your bases. You say, Lord, keep me in line with you. Let me do your precepts, and the main one is to forgive others so you can forgive me, and make sure that my belly is full so I can continue to praise you. That covers your basic basis. That's it. But prayers go a lot deeper than that, don't they? That's just a basic prayer that we can teach our kids to get in the habit of praying. But real prayers are in John. Let's go over to John 17. John 17, 1. Now, this is the prayer that Jesus had while he was in the Garden of Gethsemane. John 17, verse 1. After saying all these things, Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so he can give glory back to you. For you have given him authority over everyone, and he gives eternal life to each one you have given him. And this is the way to eternal life, to know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, the one you sent to earth. I brought glory to you here on earth by completing the work you gave to me. Now, Father, bring me into the glory we shared before the world began. I have revealed you to the ones who you gave me from this world. They were always yours. You gave them to me and have kept your word. Now that's just the first six verses. It's like 21 more verses after that. They don't sound the same, do they? They're both prayers, but doesn't the second one sound like a conversation? Mm-hmm. Like a conversation between a father and a son, or a mother and a daughter, or a friend, or a wife, or a husband? It's a conversation. A prayer is a conversation, and the only way for you to thank God is to have a conversation.
Yes, amen.
Thank him with your mouth. Have that conversation. Next, you need to tell somebody. You know, David, a man after God's own heart, he did something in 1 Chronicles 29:13. And he said, we're going to start in verse 12. Wealth and honor came from you alone, for you rule over everything. Power and might are in your hand, and at your discretion, people are made great and given strength. Oh, our God, we thank and praise your glorious name. David was speaking to an assembly of Israelites, to his followers, who he was made king over, his subjects. That was a declaration, a speech saying, this is what God has done, this is what he's doing, and we need to thank him. And in other parts of Chronicles and Kings, not only do they say, we need to bless the Lord, and the whole host of people, y'all is a lot of folks, said amen. So you have to tell somebody of the goodness of the Lord and how he has blessed you. Because if you tell them how God has been good to you, they're going to want that too. You know, anything you can do, I can do better. You know, we do have that little spirit of competition in us. And God knows that. That's why Israel was made the model nation. In Genesis 18:18, you don't have to go there, but write it down and you can check it out later. He told Abraham, I will make you the model nation so that the whole world may be saved through your descendants. He didn't say your descendants to be saved through your descendants. He said the whole world to be saved through your descendants. That means Jew and Gentile alike. And truth be told, we probably all got a little Jew Israelite in us. So everybody's been mixed up with everybody. So not only do you have the inheritance of God through the fact that you're a human being, but you have it because somewhere along the line, you have part of the 12 tribes of Israel in you. Let's just, you know, let's just call a spade a spade. So, if the Lord is blessing you with all this awesome stuff, other people are going to be like, okay, wait a minute. What is this Jesus thing? Kind of like what they do with plexus. All right, you're losing weight. You're looking good. What are you doing? I want some too. That's how we need to be with the Word of God.
Amen.
We need to be such examples that that's what people say. Have you guys ever wondered why, or maybe not why, or haven't, God maybe has not sent certain people into your life? Have you had a chance to mentor someone to the Lord? No one brings anyone to Christ. Christ, that is something that has worked out between him and God the Father. He just uses you as a physical representation of him so that you can actually talk to someone and you can hear a voice back. When's the last time God sent someone to you so that you could be an example to them? We got to think about that.
Amen.
And if God hasn't sent you an example in a while, you might want to check your example. Because he won't send a babe in Christ to someone who's hot and cold. There'll be no Laodiceans that he's going to send to someone who is a babe in Christ. He's not going to send you if you got 1 foot in the world and 1 foot in the church. He's not going to do that because you may cause that person to stumble or you may stunt their spiritual growth. So we as Christians, we have to make sure our example is on point.
Amen.
So that we can bring that glory to God. So that other people can be thankful that God rescued them out of the muck and the mire. Remember, he told us we are to be the salt of the earth. We are to give flavor to a dull and impoverished world. We are supposed to be the city on top of the hill at night. You're supposed to be that way in your family, in your job, in your community, in your church. Imagine a bunch of bright lights in one church. I mean, everybody would come running that God needs to work with. And the way he's working with you is the way he's going to work with them. So he's going to bring them to where they need to be worked with. Not every church is for everybody. Please remember that. Not every church is for everybody. Some people need milk, and that's all they need. So they go to a church that gives you good milk, maybe even buttermilk. Some of us need meat.
Yes.
Some of us need not just chicken or fish. No, we need steak. Something to chew and swallow.
That's right.
Because we wouldn't believe it no other way.
Right.
You know how some people just take it on faith. No, some of us is hardened. And we got to not take it on faith. We got to take it on sight and everything else. So we need to see. No, don't give me them famous scriptures. No, I don't need the famous scriptures. I need the non-famous scriptures. I need you to tell me about who Hezekiah really was. He wasn't no singing artist. No, he was the king of Israel. I need to really know who Ruth and Esther were. I need to know the seed of Jesse. Everyone says, well, the Lord gave me the seed of Jesse. Well, who was Jesse? So when you got somebody like that, God is going to send you to a church that is going to delve deeper into the scripture. But guess what, y'all? When it all comes down in the end, scripture.
That's right.
That's the beauty of the Lord. We can thank him for meeting us where we're at.
Right, amen.
Each and every one of us know that where we came from. But you know what? Through the scripture, we know where we're going.
Amen.
Next is you do the Lord's work. Obey him.
Yes.
What pride does a godly pride, not the abomination pride, but the godly pride that you have when your son or daughter does what you say? And they do it because it's a good thing, and guess what? It works out for their benefit.
Amen.
You know, baby, go to school and get an education. And they go to school and they get that education.
Amen.
And then in your old age, they take care of you.
Yes.
You just well up. You just want to tell everybody.
Amen.
Yes, yes, my baby was an obedient child. And they did what I said. Now look at them and me now. And that's what God wants. He wants to say to the host of heaven and Satan, look at my child doing exactly what I told him to do. And you see how I blessed them and they blessed us? I'm proud of my servant. Good and faithful. That's what I want to hear. I don't want to hear, well, Crystal, sorry, baby, but just didn't make it. I don't want to hear that. Because there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth on my end. But I want to hear good and faithful servant. So we need to be obedient. King Saul, for those of you that know him, and for those of you out in TV land who don't know him yet, King Saul was very disobedient, very prideful, and he did not repent. So this particular time, he panics, and he's like, well, Samuel's not here, and we're losing the battle, and I don't know what to do, and I'm playing right here, and everybody's looking at me, I'm doing whatever I want to do. He didn't, because see, every king had God's Holy Spirit, so don't think that they didn't. Now, their subjects may not have, but they did. In order to rule their people, God had to give them his spirit, and they had to talk to one another. So he can't talk to his non-spirit. He needs to talk to his spirit. So he's screaming and panicking. So he says, you know what? Samuel's taking too long. I don't know what he's doing, but we need to go ahead and make these sacrifices so we can win. And he did. And the number one rule is, you, king person, everyone else in Israel, are not to make sacrifices. The priest and the Levitical priesthood, the Levites, you can't even be from a non-Levitical family to make sacrifices. So he goes on ahead and he makes the sacrifices and it hits the fan. And Samuel comes down and he said, what have you done? Because remember, God sees everything. So he told Samuel what Saul was doing. And he comes to, what have you done? It was almost like you idiot. I cannot work with you. Go away. So he's like, man, not only have you messed up the church's money, but you done messed the whole thing up for the community bake sale. Oh! You in trouble now. I hate to see you. So he told him, he said, God is going to take the kingdom away from you. He said, obedience is better than sacrifice. No, you can't sacrifice 100 bulls and get out of this mess. No.
Amen.
The kingdom will be taken from you and all your descendants are going to die. There will be no more Saul descendants. Including the girl that you gave to King that you will give to King David that you don't know at the time, but she will be barren too. Nothing of yours is going to survive, even your good son Jonathan, because you were disobedient to the point where God had had enough. So obedience is better than sacrifice. But when you're obedient, like his predecessor, David, you are given, there is no king on earth that is more talked about than King David. Michelangelo made a statue that's sitting over there in Florence. And do you guys know on a rainy day when I had the opportunity to go to Florence to see the statue of David, that it was a 2-hour wait to see the statue of David? And it was pouring down rain, like the sheets. But there was still a 2-hour line to see the statue of David. King David is revered from his time into our time now because he was obedient to God. And when he sinned, he repented with his whole heart. Everything in his body he repented with. And he was called a man after God's own heart. And he had women, wine, and song. And then he blessed his seed. King Solomon's mines, they're still looking for him. They're still looking for his money. Because he had so much of it. I mean, he had gifts from the Queen of Sheba. He told the king in Egypt, look here, man. We're going to go ahead and dap this on out. Bring me your girl. I'm going to marry her. We're going to be family. And in return, I'm going to need you to help me out with the temple. All right? I'll help you out with the temple. He had favor. It was peace throughout the land. People would come and sit around and listen to his wisdom. Just come and sit. They would send emissaries. Well, look, I can't go because I got to rule the land. But I'm going to send you, you, and you, and y'all go to Solomon, and y'all sit and listen, and then bring it back to me. So when you're obedient, he blesses you, and he blesses your descendants. But when you're disobedient, like Solomon became, you're going to have to reap the consequences of your disobedience. So if you want to show your complete thankfulness for what God has done for you in your life, is be obedient. And he's going to love you anyway, but oh, he's just going to have a smile on his face when he talks about you. And look here, don't be afraid when God talks about you. Don't think that what happened to Job is going to happen to you. Don't think like that. But when he talks about you, he's talking about you for a good reason. And if you do have a trial, it's to show the world that God is God all by himself. Yeah. So communication is key in any relationship, especially the one we have with God. You got to talk things out. You got to talk to him. You got to talk about it. And you got to be obedient to what he says. Read your Bible. You won't know what to be obedient to unless you read. You won't know what his commandments are unless you read. Yes, the placard at Grandma's house is quite nice. However, in Romans, he goes on further to say, don't cause your neighbor to stumble. If he don't eat meat, don't eat meat around him. And neighbor, don't look at him crazy if he eats meat. The Ten Commandments happened in Exodus. This happened in Romans. If you don't read the whole Bible, you will miss the boat. When you read the Bible, that is God directly talking to you. And when you pray, that is you directly talking to God. So we have to have a two-way communication. This is not a dictatorship where I tell you. This is a relationship where we tell each other. So, remember that Jesus is your elder brother. And even if you don't have a good relationship with your siblings, whatever, You have a relationship with the ultimate sibling, Jesus Christ. Because he's going to take care of you when they can. But if you have a good relationship with your siblings, use that as a basis.
Amen.
When you talk to them, that's how you talk to Jesus. Because he's gonna look out for you in a respectful manner. You can't be using all kind of words when you talk to Jesus. You've got to curtail that. However, talk to him. Now, I told you at the beginning, I was going to leave you guys with a challenge. And for those of you that were in Bible study, you know what the challenge is, and I hope you guys are on your third or fourth day. And the challenge is that every day, write down something you're thankful for. Something that someone has done for you, something that God has allowed someone to do for you, or a feeling that you get, or God has used you to be a vessel or a light or a piece of salt in someone's life. Write it down and put it in a box or a jar. Get you a little pretty box, ladies. Men, get you a nice box. Perfume or cologne boxes are great for this thing. And you write it down on a little piece of paper. And if those of you that like to do journal entries, write it down in your journals. But mark it every day. And this time next year, because remember, this is the beginning of God's year. We know man's year, and we honor that. But this is God's year. So at the beginning of God's year, next year this time, go over and read what God has done for you and what you're thankful for. And when you got a mouthful of thank you, you won't have a head full of negativity. So we, as a church, I challenge you to do this every day. And every 3 months at Bible study, so Uncle will work some out. Every 3 months, we're going to bring our thankful boxes to Bible study. And we're going to let each other know what we're personally thankful for. You read a couple of days and say, I was thankful for this, I was thankful for that. And the next person, I was thankful for this and thankful for that. So you got a bunch of thank yous going up. God is proud of that.
Yes.
He smiles on that. He's like, you're not taking me for granted. We don't like to be taken for granted and taken advantage of. So you know God doesn't like to be taken advantage of. And we're just ourselves with our maybe 50 plus people that we know. But he has billions. So let's not add to that, but let's add to his smiles,
yes,
and his pleasant talks and conversation with the host. So please do, church, get your thankful boxes. Write down on your pieces of paper of what you're thankful for each and every day. And I guarantee you that your life will change around for the better, because you can actually tell someone what you're thankful for, and they just may come and see what this Christ and Jesus thing is all about.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.